Hi, everybody. The legendary bass player Red Mitchell once told me that jazz is a music that is thought and felt and played simultaneously. Upon hearing that, I suggested that sport, then, is the closest thing to jazz, an athletic dance of sorts, designed yet spontaneous, rigid yet flowing. At its best, a great performance in sport is like the greatest performances in jazz, unpredictable and powerful, unsettling at times, taking something that wasn't there a moment before and creating a moment that will never be quite the same again. Today, we welcome back again a man of music and a man of sport, a man of jazz. He's multiple Grammy Award winner, Wynton Marsalis. We'll take a look at his best in sport through his eyes and his uniquely articulate point of view later. One-on-one with the guy that they can't cover one-on-one. His name is Jerry Rice of the San Francisco 49ers, who caught 6 touchdowns in the last 2 weeks. We'll find out why the rice is sizzling. There's Jerry. But the man who is clean at the present time, Wynton Marsalis. This is true. Being clean is an important thing for you. Being clean as in how you are properly attired, sir.
Yes, it's a very important tradition. This was established by many jazz musicians down through the years and Americans, and I feel it is my job to maintain this legacy.
Last time you were on our show, you said, "Hey, man, I'm not clean today." You came with a T-shirt on,
yes,
and like a, you know, one of those caps, you know. But you definitely.
Yeah.
What do you call this? This whole attire here. What kind of pants are these here?
Well, these are just pants of great style, and they have nuance. See, you see these pants, nuance. And you notice the socks. See if we can get down
there
on these socks.
The
see the socks, or you can't really see the color.
Uh-huh.
See what's happening with the socks, and then the tie. Catch the tie. See, the tie is coordinated with the sock.
Uh-huh.
And it's a very subtle play that's organized in a very artistic fashion.
Yet it makes a statement.
It makes a very high, elegant statement.
We're getting silly here.
You know, I had to make up for the last time. I disrespected
right.
the show. I came on here raggedy, and it's my job to try to.
You have done so. You have made up for it. Thank We're going to take your 5 main men of sport, or people in your mind right now, on your mind, opinions for different reasons of the following. Let's start with a guy who you like a lot, who broke the mold, Bo Jackson. They told him he could do this or do that. He can't do both, and he is.
Definitely. I really like Bo Jackson because first, he doesn't talk a lot. He's cool, and he lets his playing speak for him. You know, he came in as a rookie into baseball this year, and he started off real hot, and then he kind of slumped a little bit, and everybody immediately started attacking him, you know. And he's a very sensitive guy. I saw him in an interview, and I could tell that he was hurt by the way he was attacked, because, you know, people like athletes represent, the people who make the pros represent the best. You know, just to make it into the pros is a great achievement.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody like Bo Jackson playing 2 sports, that's unheard of. You saw what he did last night. He was running over people, past them, around them. And I know it takes tremendous dedication and fortitude to pursue the sport and become as great as he is in both of them.
Mm-hmm.
And also he has like that speech impediment that he had to get over, and he's done a great job. And he does a lot of things working with kids. And he's also like a homeboy, you know, he's from the South.
Mm-hmm.
And he has the
11 kids in his family growing up in Alabama.
He's soulful, you know. He has like that Southern vibe.
Mm.
And I really like it. It's dignified.
Talk about dignity. The guy that, from a historical perspective, is one of your main men, Bill Russell, now coach of the Sacramento Kings. Look at that face.
Yeah, man, I love him. He's a jazz fan, too. And Bill Russell would be like my favorite sports figure. The man won all those championships, the last coach to coach back-to-back championships. Mm-hmm. In the NBA, player coach, he's just a man, intelligent.
You and I were having a discussion, though, about Mr. Russell and the press's depiction of Russell as a guy who's just coming in there to take the check. You know, he doesn't really want to be coaching the Sacramento Kings. You don't buy that.
You see, they don't like him because he doesn't cheese enough. You know, they always want people deferring and cheesing and acting like they don't know what's going on. And the thing about Bill Russell, he's a very serious man. He's noble, you know, he has some dignity. He wants to act like an adult. Now, he had fun when he was playing the game. He won all those championships, but that doesn't mean he wanted to act like he acted when he was 6 or 7.
Mm-hmm.
He's a man.
Dignity is the common strain with Andre Dawson, a man who obviously didn't take the check with the Chicago Cubs. In fact, took a $500,000 pay cut to play in Chicago because that's where he wanted to play.
Definitely. And you know, he doesn't talk a bunch of off-the-wall stuff. He's very quiet. He went out, he let his bat do the talking. He won the MVP, which he deserved. And, you know, it's nothing I can really say to add to his achievement.
Isaiah Thomas talked, and talked maybe once too often, perhaps, in the context of how the press took it, in the midst of his discussion last year about Mr. Bird. He was forced to apologize for apparently uttering something that if Larry were black, he'd just be another good player. You thought that was misrepresented?
Well, the first thing, I know it was misrepresented because I heard the tape when they played it. And the thing that I hate the most about media and things like athletics and music is a lot of times these writers are jealous of the people who are playing it and doing it. So they feel it's their job to attack. They're like piranhas, you know. The first chance they get a chance to blow anything out of proportion, they do it. And the thing that I want to understand is why is the guys who are known for the objective acts of sports, which we know Isaiah Thomas is one of the best in the NBA, why is what he says elevated? He's not Jesse Jackson. Mm-hmm. He's a ball player. Mm. Talk about what he's doing on the court. I mean, my little brother Jason plays basketball. Mm-hmm. You know, he's not Isaiah Thomas.
There is a bigger story, though, behind the Isaiah Thomas controversy, and that is this. Throughout the playoffs, a lot of members of the press and media, broadcasters, depict Larry Bird as the workmanlike, hard-working, blue-collar player, and he certainly is that. But the black player is the, quote, instinctive player, the guy who comes out of the womb with a born talent, you know what I mean? And to me, that if it's conscious or unconscious, it's still a kind of racism on the part of the press.
Yeah, and that also affects musicians. And you know, what people have to realize, white and black people have to realize, is this lowers the level of all of American thinking. And the same thing has happened in music. People, Louis Armstrong, he was an intuitive genius. He didn't know what he was doing. Well, if you can do something, that's proof that you know what you're doing and that you figured something out. Mm. That is all you need. Now, from a heuristic standpoint, I mean, talent doesn't get you into the pros. I grew up with guys who had talent. None of them are in the pros. They're still in Canada, in New Orleans, playing in the gym. And I think that it's not a thing. Larry Bird definitely works hard and practices, but so does Moses Malone. Mm-hmm. And he's definitely a great player who has great impact on players around him.
Yeah.
So does Magic Johnson. So does Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. So did Bill Russell when he was playing, and I'm sure he's working now as a coach. And the thing that I hate to see is when these athletes are expected to defer to people because they're in the media, when the athletes have worked much harder on their job than these media people have worked a lot of the times, and they really don't owe them the respect of deferring to them or their judgments on what they do.
Talking about great players, this guy's a great player on stage. Incidentally, appearing at the Westwood Playhouse in Los Angeles, playing his horn, Wynton Marsalis, 7-time Grammy Award winner.
That's me.
We'll come back in just a few moments. We'll talk a little bit about jazz and sport and the playing of the national anthems after this.
Does thy star-spangled
guests on Sports Look receive the Impulse 2, the all-new home exercise bike from XL. Featuring digital displays of time, miles, and distance, it even shows how many calories you burned from XL, the exercise company.
Last year on our program, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar congratulated Wynton Marsalis on doing one of the most happening, as he put it, national anthems he had ever heard prior to a game. I guess it was at the Super Bowl. Did you like the way you played your national anthem?
What we did was good. I don't know how it sounded, you know, the sound. I think we should have mixed the tape up a little more or something. Mm-hmm. You couldn't really hear everything in the background.
There is something to the national anthem these days. Almost every celebrity seems to be singing one or playing one, but I guess the most famous of all was the one in 1983 at the NBA All-Star Game when Marvin Gaye sang the national anthem.
Say, does
the late Marvin Gaye. Jim Brown told me it was the first time he heard that song, it made him cry, made him feel about the national anthem that he should have felt all these years, he said.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Well, if you checked out in the national anthem, the people were clapping on 2 and 4. And you know, that's what America's role has been in the world from a musical standpoint, is to put the world on 2 and 4. Starting with Stravinsky in the early 1900s with the Writer's Spring and Petrushka and all of those ballets. He was the first European composer to understand how to put a backbeat in his music, and it made his music much more popular, gave it an extra bite.
You went to a fight or saw a fight, the Tommy Hearns fight, where Aretha Franklin sang the national anthem. What'd she do to her?
She was killing. She had a Fender Rhodes and she sat down and she sang, you know, because she really can sing a gospel style, not the fake gospel melismas that we hear today. She's really a singer in that style. And the thing that people should understand is that people like Marvin Gaye, there are only a few artists on that level from a phrasing standpoint. Like when you hear him singing the Star Spangled Banner, it's not just any random person singing it. It's a man who spent a long time dealing with music and trying to understand how that music can best depict what goes on in America.
Sometimes the music parallels the sport. We did a piece with Wynton last year for our Lakers show here in Los Angeles, and we tried to parallel jazz and artistry and basketball all rolled up into one. Here's what it said.
Some say art is a strictly intentional act and not the byproduct of a game or a sport. That sport is merely the development of skills and not technique. They scoff at the notion that an athlete can be an artist. But Marsalis says basketball is very much an art form.
The main proposition of art is to extend, elaborate, and refine a style. They have the pretty moves, and I mean, you get points for style. Mm-hmm. Style is an aesthetic proposition, so it has to be an art.
The art continues on the court. You still impress with Michael Jay. Michael Jordan is the main man at this particular time.
To me, he's the man because he's great at defense. He has no weaknesses. He can go to left, right, jump off of either foot. He can shoot free throws. He's disciplined. He has the mentality. He has the style, the soul, the intellect. He has the whole package.
Are you disappointed that America in general doesn't view the jazz circles as it views the sports circles?
I'm disappointed, but you know, our country in general right now, we're having some problems with our education system and just our understanding who we are and what our role is in the world. And we have to understand that our job is to develop democracy. Hmm. Develop democracy and what that means. That way you won't be upset over Isaiah Thomas cracking a joke about Larry Bird. Hmm. That's what a democracy breeds, or Michael Jackson's nose. He's eccentric. That's part of a democracy. Develop the conception of free rights for all, but the responsibilities of self-government.
Wynton Marsalis. We'll come back with more after this.